Kent Hill School, in association with the Huskies on the Web Live, present to you today the 2022 to 2023 Learning Exhibition. Hello, everybody. I am your host, Norris Andrews. And as always, we are back here in the Bodmin for the third semester since COVID, the opening of the 2022-2023 school year, the Learning Exhibition. As we did the last two semesters, we'll be looking at different exhibitions of people's learning and what classes are doing and what the curriculum provides for the students here at Kent Hill School. So, to start us off here immediately, we're going to have Mr. Brian Smith. His hip-hop class is going to do some slam poetry for us, so that's going to start off for us off today. So, let's go inside.
Just letters and numbers at this point. And they're doing stuff kind of in real time. There are some robotic students there as well with projects to display. So if you get a chance, walk over to the lower level of the Aiken. There's lots of cool stuff happening. The other thing that I wanted to announce, and this is cool too, Brian Smith, Smitty, he's teaching a class this year that's called Context for Hip Hop. And as part of the early part of the class, students are studying the history of African-American music, and among other things, his students are doing this really cool project where they write original slam poems. These particular poems, you get to hear four of them. They're about sort of power and privilege. And so I'm really excited here to announce, I think this is in the correct order, Alvin Nixon, Marcus Macchione, Theo Demopoulos, and Ethan Smith. Nope, sorry, Ethan Smith, then Theo Demopoulos.
Most of us black people go flex on the internet. Fake news and the beef, we internet. That's how we're losing black men and they getting whack. Cause they broke on their knees but ain't sold a pack. They for God gave this life, ain't no turning back. And the ones who raised me told me never slack. But at the end they gon' hate just because I'm black. But for now we got all this jewelry and all these chains wrapped around like the slaves that they bought. They shooting up children and beating up bystanders. How many colors got shot? Way too many, so my parents was living from check to penny. They were out on their own before age of 20. Ain't got time for no parties, no drinks or henny. Coming straight out of high school right down to America. Leveled up and they breaking down barriers. Stay treated different because of their character and the white men who think they're superior. Hold on, my fault. Overthinking them nights and got scarier. Getting judged at no matter the area. Feeling used by my friends because of the color of my skin. Just because I'm black, they don't want to see us win.
I'm Marcus. As I walk a fine line between hazy and light, sometimes I wake up feeling black, other days I feel white. How is a kid at 17 supposed to find an escape with so few people around him to whom he can relate? 6'3", 250, hair curly but straight, turning two directions trying to decipher my fate. As I sit here in this school, in this building, I feel privileged. It's because I am. I didn't struggle or cross no burning bridges. While the other 50% of me doesn't know how to fit in and who to be, I get grouped in with the so-called thugs that are around me. Just because I don't have to look twice when the police start to surround me, this doesn't mean I haven't been in situations where my heart skips a beat. I feel like in these situations, it wasn't because of the color, but because of me. This could have been the reason why I'm here and able to tell you that. Maybe a little darker and stuff might not have been like that. Thank you.
I'm Ethan. 5'8 with shoes on my feet. Winter comes around, I ain't worried about heat. I'm still fighting for life when it comes to disease. But when a cop comes around, I can move with ease. Don't work every weekend, stuff is handed to me. I don't ask for it to happen, but that's just how it be. My mama cried most nights, not because I cease to be, because my words sting. Shame on me. I've been feeling low lately, kind of sad, rather mad. Trying to fight and it hurt me bad. This feeling I'm feeling, spoiled a tad, not taking advantage of life, instead letting pass me by. I thank you, Mom and Dad, you gave me this life. Now I'll make the best of it, and I'll learn to survive.
Coming from Canada, going to Hookset, there's this thing called white privilege that I had finally met. On the road with my high school hockey team, excited to play and step up our games in every which way. We were headed to America. Us Canadians knew hockey was played more scrappy, but we didn't think that others would be calling our goaltender a blackie. See, our goalie, he was our homie, a white boy from Montreal. We saw him as our equal because that's just how we worked on that team. We were all the same people. Now we faced belligerent opposition that were on a mission to put down black people because they thought they were in a higher position. Sometimes you have to see it from a different perspective to understand how effective bad energy could be, especially when it's collective. Now see, our opponents, they never said anything bad about the white kids. They only sent hate to our black teammate. In front of our net, they said slurs to our goalie, disrespected our goalie, hit our goalie. But during the face-off, when there were no people of color, they were cool and tapered off and sparked regular conversations with no hesitations. Honestly, it was distasteful that people were judged for the color of their skin. My team understood that, but the others, they were unable. It was like a cable was filling these kids with cruelty. See the comments they made though, we didn't take them loosely. Doesn't mean we're white, that we can't stand against prejudice of any type. So that tournament, we made it known to any team that faced us, they couldn't faze us because when they hazed us, we were too united for them to break us. Racism isn't wired, it's acquired. One day we'll spread love instead of hate. Equality will be accomplished, and white privilege will be abolished. Thank you.
One more time for all of them.
And that was a beautiful display of slam poetry by Smitty's, by Brian Smith's hip-hop class, Context for Hip-Hop. Very great slam poetry, as we just saw, about the prejudice that people of color in America face. Now, as a person of color myself, I found that to be very powerful and very educating to everyone out there about that subject. With that being said, let's move on. And we'll get to some interviews and get some more classes, because I'm sure everyone enjoyed that first one, and we've got so much more to go. Thank you. All right, everyone, for our first technical walk-up interview, for our second display, technically, we'll be going to...
My name is Zachary Braithwood.
And Zachary Braithwood, and obviously a regular member here on the HAL. Great to see him actually on the camera front instead of behind it, you know. But, Zach, tell me, what are you doing here today?
What we're doing right now is the results of last year's vocab contest. So the vocab contest where we took it from the New York Times, where we were given a list of about 50 words and we had to pick one and then make a 15-second video about it, as you can see on the screen there. These are the five finalists, which we can see there. There's Noah Katz with Flummoxed, and it is a... We had very funny sketches. It was a very tight race at the end, but it was just showing how creative people can be. This was all English departments who did it.
Yes, a great display of creativity indeed, as last year this was shown off, and it's great that the New York Times actually stepped in and enjoyed all the videos. Also, you know, New York Times being a very big publishing company and a very big producer of literature and media. Now, Zach, what was yours? What was your video about?
Mine is actually right there. I had the word perilous, so I decided to, with help from during JV hockey practice, with help with, I got a shout out, Carson Palmer and Lucas Reinhardt, as they both helped us film, and I was just playing hockey, and then I would get boarded. So I won because it was very humorous, and it very deeply showed what the word meant.
All right, that will do it. Thank you, Zach.
Thank you, Norris.
And that is Zachary with the Kent Hill Vocab Video Contest, which took place last year, but we're going to reshow for this year just because it shows how great that our English department could be, especially when put on a national stage like the New York Times. So that'll do it. Thank you, Zachary, and we'll move on. I am here with
Alvin Nixon.
And Alvin Nixon, as we all just saw, was up with Context for Hip Hop, taught by Brian Smith, doing slam poetry, which a great poem about comparing how people of color in this country face differences in prejudice and discrimination. So Alvin, tell me, what inspired you? Some of the lyrics that took me aback was about the chains and the jewelry in your clothing. What inspired you for that?
In context of hip hop, we're just talking about the history of hip hop and the origin of everything. So we get to like see the origin of rap and how it originated from jazz and blues and all that. So it just got to me in some of the videos that they showed, like of displaying black people. You would see them in like, you know, just chains and stuff. Like, you know, like that's how they would just get moved in slavery. But now you see in modern day, people of color usually tend to have chains and jewelry to signify that they have money or to flex in front of people, just that type of origin. So that's how I got that, the meaning of that lyric in that song.
So obviously the juxtaposition of jewelry and how it changed from a negative connotation to a positive connotation with a wealth status and symbols. Do you think about that, like, day to day, like, what jewelry should I wear, what jewelry shouldn't I wear, like, and, like, was there some, like, personal, like, thought that went into the poem?
Towards that, I would say, I mean, to me, the jewelry is very important to me. Like, it's just something I can signify myself with. My chain here, I have the A. That's my mom's initial. My mom's name's Alice. My name's Alvin. So it's just something I can keep with me, just knowing that I always have my mom with me. But towards that, not really. I just try to keep it low-key and just do what I'm feeling, yeah.
All right, and I think that'll be it for you. Thank you, Alvin. Very powerful stuff there.
Hi, Mom.
He says hello to his mother. We will move on to some more classes here, as we did get a follow-up for the slam poetry in Context of Hip Hop. So, anyways, we move on.
Hey, oh.
Like, what's going on? All right, I am here with
Evan Slotnick.
And Evan, what class is this?
This is AP Psychology.
So Evan Slotnick, obviously another one of our HAL members, so graciously here doing his class displays for AP Psychology for the learning exhibition this year. And tell us, what is this assignment about?
So this assignment is a correlational study. Our hypothesis for the assignment was that the more AP classes a student has taken, the more flags that they can correctly name in the dining commons. As you can see down here, this is the dining commons. As you can see, there's a lot of flags in here. This picture was taken a long time ago, but there's more flags right now. This is all our data right here. It's making it a lot easier for people to see. We have a graph made for the viewer. As you guys can see, the number of AP classes and the number of flags named don't really have any correlation whatsoever. The high AP class numbers right here are lower, and the lower AP classes right here have a higher flag name. This outlier right here is the reason that our data gets all screwed up. Any questions?
So how was this based? What was the sampling size for this assignment?
Our sampling size was 10 students. As you can see back up here, we also mixed it up and had 4 international students, 2 from North America, as Matt and Theo are both Canadian, 1 and 2 from Europe, as Pavel right here is from Slovakia, and Henrik right here is from Germany. Other than that, we did 6 other kids from the United States of America.
And do you think that played a role in their identification of flags, like whether they are from the United States or outside the United States or from outside of North America?
Absolutely. The kids from the international kids named a lot more flags than the kids from the United States. And Matt was, I believe, the lowest person with 30 from the international scale. As Theo named 39, Pavel named 37. Henrik was the lowest with 23. But generally, the kids from international had higher scores.
And to tie it all back, how do you think this plays into the psychology of being from America and being educated? Because we all know America's curriculum is very based in what's inside of our country. And do you think that has something to do with Americans naming less flags on the wall?
You know, I don't really think it has anything to do with it, to be honest. I think that, like, flags are something that you just acquire over time. There's no really classes that you just say, yeah, name this flag, name this flag. I think it's just more about being cultured on a global scale instead of an American scale. So I do think that Americans could be more cultured on what happens in other countries. But as far as education domestically, I don't really think it has a big impact or, like, anything noteworthy.
All right, and that'll do it for all the time we have today, as we do have a lot to get through today. Thank you, Evan.
Yes.
And that was Evan Slotnick with AP Psychology. We will get back to more interviews here in a second. Thank you. It's good. Yo, can I do y'all? Can I do y'all? Interview y'all? Can I? Okay, this looks sick. Okay, this actually looks sick. All right, Okay. You can... All right, so I am back here, everyone, and I am with...
Oh, hi, I'm Kaylee Feeney.
I'm Hannah Burke.
And we are here for the class of...
2023.
And what?
AP two-dimensional art.
All right, so AP two-dimensional art here. As we take a look around, you see some great paintings on display here, everyone. We're just going to give it a second to really soak in the bright colors and bright designs here. You see the two here, Kaylee and Hannah, working on stuff themselves at the moment. So tell me, what exactly is AP two-dimensional art?
So basically, we had to make a portfolio of 15 pieces, and it's all formed around like a main idea. And you can kind of just make whatever you want. Like, we have a wide array of styles and mediums and all that good stuff. So, yeah.
And what exactly is your main idea?
Um, So my idea was I was doing art based on different love languages. It's kind of changed a little bit, but that was what I was doing. Hannah, what were you doing?
I'm taking pictures out of my camera roll, and I'm only using the three basic colors, blue, red, and yellow, and black and white, and I am mixing them and making paintings.
That is fantastic. As art, as we know, is one of our key strengths here at Kent Hill. Very great art program. Obviously, we have painting, there's drawing classes, ceramics, 3D printing. So, a lot of great art programs here. And tell me, I see there's a lot of variation in colors and design. You said this is based off of love languages, correct?
Oh, yeah, that's what I was doing, yeah.
And can you sort of, like, walk me through here very quickly, like, what each picture represents, or at least some of them?
Oh, so these are from our entire class, but I know for mine, so that one was based on, like really close relationships, close love, and then that one was done for self-love. And I know Hannah was doing camera roll photos, so that one was from her camera roll, so was that one, and so was this one as well. Yeah.
Yeah, very great image, very great paintings here. Definitely above my level of painting. And, you know, again, this goes to show Kent Hill's great art programs here. So if you're into art, definitely check this class out, maybe enroll in it sometime. You know, they're definitely doing a better job than I could. All right, that's all the time we have. Thank you, too. Hands filled with paint. All right, that's AP Two-Dimensional Art, everybody. We'll come back with more interviews here in a second. How we doing, bud? What? Okay, we'll do that after. Now? Okay. But there's a bunch of people there.
Oh, there's people there right now.
Yeah, there's people there right now. Yeah, that's what I was going to do. All right. All right, everyone. I am here with...
My name is Cordell Pern.
And with the class, or what class?
So this isn't for a class. This is actually through an organization, a brother organization we have in Cape Town, South Africa, with the school Bishop's Diocesan College, which I actually had the amazing opportunity of studying abroad at this summer.
So technically an independent study with... More or less an independent study with Cordell here studying abroad and in Cape Town, South Africa, which some Kent Hill students have the opportunity to go to Cape Town, South Africa. Us and a few schools over there have some exchange programs. We currently have students who are from the exchange program and are here for the current semester. As Cordell had the opportunity to go over the summer and go to Cape Town, South Africa. So you sort of walk us through your experience here.
Yeah, cool. So I think academically it was a very different experience for me. The school was structured very differently, so I went to an all-boys school. I could tell you a little bit about that. I was in a house called White House, so a little bit like Hogwarts. You have like White House, Schoolhouse, Kid House, Ogilvy House, Bird House, like, and you participate in sporting events with these houses. You eat with these houses. They're basically your family. And so this is right outside of White House here. You get a really nice view of Table Mountain, which is an enormous landmark in Cape Town. This is White House itself. So yeah, that's sort of a little bit about my stay in the school itself. Other than that, a lot of opportunities I had were to go hiking and spend some time in the greater Cape Town area and explore South Africa. Got to spend a lot of time in the city, and that meant a lot to me for a lot of reasons. I had a great time, yeah.
Well, I'm glad you had a great time, Corey. Can you tell us about how Cape Town and sort of the main area and Kent Hill like differed from each other?
Right. So, Cape Town is a super multicultural city. very diverse, both because of its colonial history and obviously being in Africa. There's a lot there, as well as in recent years with a lot of economic development. Cape Town, the city, is very, very robust economically, so there's a lot going in that direction. And so it's very interesting, right, because there's a lot of people from a lot of different backgrounds. And yeah, so that's very different than how I grew up, because I grew up in Belgrade, Maine, right near Kent's Hill, and going to Kent's Hill School. And yeah, could you clarify the question a little bit more?
I was mainly asking, like, what are some of, like, the cultural differences? How is living different? Like, conditions?
Yeah, things are a lot cheaper, which I learned, and that was really nice. So we got to eat out a lot for much less of a price. People are really sweet in South Africa. People are always really eager to learn about me because I was an American abroad. So they're typically really curious about me. Just very welcoming. I stayed with Carl van Veen Harden, who is a current junior here at Kent's Hill. And he was my host brother while I was there. So I stayed with his family. And it was really great. One thing I recommend is that you don't get injured abroad. So I had to go to the emergency room to get some stitches in my forehead after a tennis accident. And organizing that health insurance and all those costs was super, super complicated overseas. But other than that, a great experience being in yet another country that I got to study abroad in. So
That's great, Cordell. As obviously, I take it at your own risk, obviously, but Kent's Hill does offer, again, the South Africa Exchange Program. We're able to go to South Africa for the summer, experience a semester there, which is great for learning opportunities and not only learning in a different curriculum, but also learning about different cultures around the world. So thank you, Cordell. Anyways, that was Cordell Pern, everyone, with his stay at Cape Town, South Africa. We'll come back to you with more interviews here in a minute. Here, Finn, when you're done, can we? No, take your time. We're doing this one.
What do I do?
All right, everyone. I am here with
Finn, Jared, and Green.
And Finn, you are representing
My independent study in aircraft characteristics and VFR flight.
And all right, as another independent study here, as I see that you've been the draw of attention for this event with a very big screen here and what appears to be Microsoft Flight Simulator, which is very cool. Very cool video game / simulation. And Finn, but before we do that, can you walk us through your little board here?
Yeah, so this is, I'm interested in aeronautical engineering, and so this is some basic aerodynamics that I had to do over the course of the year so far. And so this is just airfoils and just, you know, basic aerodynamic stuff, how a turn works, what ailerons do. And then over here you've got sectional charts of Boston and airspace classification, like just basic stuffs on stuff on visual flight rules, so or VFR flight, which I'm also doing in this independent study. So
that is great, Finn. A lot of information here. You got a diagram of an airplane. You said basic aerodynamics, which is important for, of course, any plane, anything that moves, really. Visual flight rules, which is always important. And a lot of great photos down there. That's you, I believe, right?
Yep, that's me flying with my instructor there.
So you fly yourself?
That's me flying there.
That is great. All right, so I assume that first, obviously, you started here. Can you walk us through what exactly is going on in this?
So this is a simulation. It's pretty accurate. It's a little sensitive, but basically you just got your general yoke here, and then you got throttles here and your flaps, which left flap right there. So I'm just showing people basically, you know, just trying to generally put it to understanding. You know, so what all this junk is, that's how what you're doing here.
And that's great, Finn, as Microsoft Flight Simulator is available for anyone that does have an Xbox or a PC. So this is great training, like even at home, right?
Yeah, it's pretty great.
Pretty realistic, too, as I saw a lot of people here earlier, which I was watching myself. The mission is to land a plane, correct?
Yes. Yep, that's the mission. And then the best score today has been 1,100,050 points. So it's we've gotten some varying skill, but yeah, pretty good.
All right, I'm not going to do it, obviously, because we don't have much time to do it. But this is very cool here. As you can see, they got the rig hooked up and everything. And again, this is something that could be accessible to most people. And you should definitely give it a try if you can. Like, maybe not on the level that Finn has, obviously. But it's still very cool that you can maybe learn to fly at home. Yeah. All right, that's all we have time for. Thank you, Finn.
Thank you.
All right, that was Finn Sheridan Crane with his independent study on aeronautics, or aircraft characteristics. We'll be back in a minute. All right. Carson, can we get you, bud? Yes, sir. Love you, Carson. All right. All right, everyone, I am here with
Carson Palmer,
representing
Hawk, the Lakefront Property Finder.
And as you see here on the table and by the little screen here, you have a lot of data and a lot of numbers here. Can you tell us really what this is all about?
Yeah, so what Hawk is supposed to do is it gets the lakefront properties for different companies to send out newsletters to solicit donations. So what we do is we map out the lakes on Google Earth with this file right here. And we have a database with a whole bunch of different properties. So we take zip codes of the different towns that we're in, and we match it with the zip codes in that. And we match it with the addresses in the tax commitment books from the different towns. And then we cross-reference them with the coordinates of the lake. And if it's determined to be less than a specific number of meters away, it's determined to be a lakefront property.
Very interesting, as lakefront properties are a very hot commodity here in Maine with the amount of lakes we have here. So this is all by near Kent Hill, or is this by like the area, by county, or is this the entire state of Maine?
So you can set different areas of where you want it, but the database that I have for the addresses is the entire state of Maine. So there's about 700,000 addresses in that, but you can really map out any lake you want if you have the correct set of data for it, and get the lakefront properties on it.
That is very great. As you see here, a lot of coordinates here. I know this probably took a lot of time and research. You know, a lot of addresses, even a real estate tax commitment book, which I gotta say, that's a lot of commitment by you.
I like what you did there.
All right, do you have a presentation here?
I don't.
Oh, you don't? That's the...
I'm sorry.
But yeah, very interesting study here. Definitely, you said this takes into account the donors we have here, correct?
Yes, so what it does is it tries to solicit donations from the different people. So I'm going to be working with the Friends of the Cobbessee Watershed to send out the donations to the people on the lakes to help clean up the lakes and make them a better place.
All right, that is a great thing to do, obviously, clean up the lakes, making it a better place for everyone to be at, which obviously the environment being a big concern at the moment. I believe this is a very good thing to do, very valuable data set to have. So that's all we have time for. Thank you, Carson.
Thank you, Norris. Have a great day.
You too, bud. And we'll come back with more interviews in a minute. Big hype.
Jenkins singing Anchor by Nova Amor.
Let me end off that real quick, and then, yeah, we're doing it, but, all right, yeah, we'll do it. We have time.
I'll stand up for this.
All right, obviously a beautiful performance by Rose Jenkins, singing Anchor by Nova Amor. Great performance. Everyone seemed to love it here. I know I certainly did. But carrying on with the interviews, I am here with
Holding Hall
and Chelsea Guerrero
representing
Consider Engineering and Renewable Biofuels.
And Consider Engineering and my summer job, which is Naughty Sisters Tea Farm.
I see you have a lot going on here. You have t-shirts, you have pamphlets, you have screens here. Can you tell us a little more about the renewable biofuels thing you have going on?
Yeah, so the Consider Engineering is actually a camp that we did, and we're offered all these different programs we can do. One is I chose renewable biofuels, so I took sunflower oil and turned it into a biodiesel. And that with that biodiesel, I basically powered an engine, which then... You know, it's things we can do now, like in today's world, like we can take fast food, old oil, and power like dump trucks and other stuff like that.
That is certainly fascinating, as Consider Engineering, I know, is a Maine-based like organization that helps with like engineering in teenagers and everything. You can do it during the summer, which I feel like this is very important research to do, considering that oil is definitely a big contentious topic right now of clean and renewable oil, correct?
That is very correct. I mean, we're trying to help our Earth out as much as we can with climate change, and this is one of the best ways to do it.
Yeah, so I did a different lab, actually. I did silver nanoparticles and their use in biomedical engineering. So we took silver nitrate and we made it like into nanoparticles, which are very, very tiny, and we tried to determine what their best use is. So they can be used in wound dressing, and they're just really effective because they're so tiny that they can get in your body and just help you heal, almost like an antibiotic or various other things.
So actually, you two studies are related but unrelated, and I actually find this very interesting, biomedical nanoparticles. You said it can help with healing and it can get in your body, which we have obviously the debate of microplastics and how, like, obviously it's very much a problem. But this nano product is actually helpful, correct?
Yeah, so there's various use for it. Hold on, let me find the slide. There's so many uses for it. I can't remember all of them since this camp was in July, but I highly recommend the camp. It really helps you understand what sort of engineering you want to go into. I went into the camp thinking I wanted to do environmental engineering, and I decided that I wanted to do chemical. So it's very helpful. A lot of scholarship opportunities from it. Yeah.
Yeah, going back off of that, scholarship opportunities is huge. They pay for most of your college. My brother's on the scholarship, and he has no college debt. Doesn't have to pay for college, so it's all worth it if you can apply for it and get into it.
So, yeah. So, you see, there are very good scholarship opportunities, but Consider Engineering. A lot of good help for the environment, and this research could really help everyone going forward, especially with climate change and renewable fuels, and obviously with the medical field and the advancement of healing products. So, thank you, Holden, and thank you, Chelsea. And that looks like we will come back to you here in a minute. So, thank you.
That was actually great.
I didn't remember what I was talking about. I literally don't know what happened in this afternoon.
Mechanical engineering. No college debt, nothing.
Really?
He gets paid to go to college. They give him a check, gets a scholarship, and then he actually makes like $2,000 from going to college.
Yeah.
toured UMaine like a few weeks ago, and they were like telling us about like a really good like engineering program, like environment and everything. They were saying something about that. I remember.
Sick.
Cool.
Hey, thank y'all.
Alright, that will do it for the Bodden section of this learning exhibition, as we are going to head over to the Aiken Learning Center, as we have some robotics displays going on over there. Thank you. Alright, I am here with, at the Aiken Learning Center, currently, I'm here with
Mr. Munson,
and representing
the... I'm going to represent the STEAM division today.
All right. STEM division here. As you see, we're in a change of scenery here. Wide array of things going on around here. So first off, I want to start with, let's start off with the thing that's actually behind our camera here. Can you tell us about this?
Yes, so this is one of the 3D printers that we have down here. And we started 3D printing about 6 years ago. And these are two new models that we got this summer. As part of the renovation for this whole space, this whole floor. So we've got Jonah's working on a print over here, and we got Renee Otto working on a print over there for his CAD design class. And then we've got two more over on the other side that were part of the original build.
That is fantastic. 3D printing obviously on the rise here with a lot of the new technology breakthroughs. As you can see, actually it's working right now. Is it printing something?
It is. Jonah, what do we got printing here right now? Is it another mug?
Yeah, it's just a miniature mug I made just for the learning exhibition. And if the camera could get the one that's already finished printing over here. Yeah, this thing. Anyway, just something easy to print and like something I can show. I just merged a few shapes together on a program called Tinkercad. It like gives you shapes that you can merge together and then export to print on these things. So. Yeah.
Wow, that seems amazing. Is see it printing in there. That's actually really cool. I don't really know much about 3D printers, so.
Well, it's pretty much just taking the layers of this filament here, and then this is just a plastic, and then it just layers it on and builds it up as it's going along. It's kind of a really cool thing, and you can do it. We can't because we're pretty much just have the plastic printers, but you can do these in glass, metals. And they're 3D printing human parts now, so that's cool.
That is fantastic. So maybe I'd come down and 3D print something sometime.
Yeah, no, definitely take it. Because there's a lot of the classes at the school. It's not just the CAD design. They print these in robotics. Some of the art department is using the 3D printers. If, you know, anybody who's really got an interest can come down to the makerspace, design something, and then print it up. So that's part of what this is all about, is that pretty much anybody could come down here and do something.
All right, that is fantastic. So do you have anything else we'd like to go over?
Yes, so a couple of the other things that we have down here, an older version of our CNC router, and that is used for carving wood out. There's a larger version, the ShopBot, up in Jordan's shop. It does a 4-foot by 8-foot bed and does some really intricate design work for furniture and all kinds of different kinds of cabinet making. The little white thing on the table over there is a Glowforge. It's a laser cutter. And that is pretty cool to watch. You can either do etching with it, you can cut shapes out with it, you can make pictures with it, all kinds of cool things with that. So the rest of the spot is just devoted to robotics. We've got the playgrounds for the robots, and then the different workstations for students to go ahead and do their programming, do their design, whatever it is they're working on. Yeah,
a lot of cool things here in the Learning Center, especially in the basement here with a lot of the engineering and STEM programs that go on at the school. But anyways, that will do it for the time we have. Thank you, Mr. Munson.
Thanks.
And with that will conclude it, everyone. So we have done everything. We have done things that we'd like to do here at the Learning Center. I recommend everyone who obviously is watching the broadcast, to everyone to check it out. And this is a great display of everything that's going on at Kent Hill academically. So with that, thank you, everyone, for your time. We'll see you next time. Thank you. I am Norris Andrews, signing you out.
So that's